Let us get ready to worship God on this wonderful Easter weekend. It is, I was glad when they said, come into the house of the Lord, yeah. Right? Yes. For on this day, we get a chance to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We will have a service as usual. We're going to begin now with the call to worship, if you would rise. Hallelujah. Let us worship God who makes all things new.
People from the shadows of despair, we emerge into the brightness of hope.
From the depths of sorrow, we rise to sing hallelujah. Love is stronger than death, and hope outlives the grave.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Ain't that a blessing? The Lord God Almighty reigns.
Hallelujah.
Let us worship God who makes all things new. All right, please join us in singing our opening song.
Thank you.
We'll now have our prayer of hope, confession and hope. I believe we sit, don't we? Yes, you may be seated. I was like, I think we sit, though. Sorry. Let us pray. Merciful God, in the light of your glory, we see the shadows of our own failings. In the story of the cross and the triumph of the empty tomb, we recognize our own struggles between belief and doubt and hope and despair. We confess that too often we have lived as though the stone has not been rolled away and as though the tomb was not empty. We have clung to our fears more tightly than to your promises, and we have hesitated to share the good news of Easter morning. We have been slow to forgive as you forgave us. We have held on to old hurts and failed to love our neighbors with the self-giving love of Christ. In the face of injustice, we have too often been silent, forgetting the power of your love to overcome the grave. But God, today we come before you, hearts open, seeking your grace. Renew us with the joy of Easter, the promise of resurrection. Forgive us for the times that we have failed to live as people of the light. Fill us anew with the hope that is found only in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. We pray for the courage to roll away the stones of our hearts, to step out of the tombs of our making, and to walk in the newness of life. Help us to live each day as Easter people, clothed in the love that conquers death, bearing witness to the light that darkness cannot overcome. Amen. Thank you. Amen, amen, amen. There is no greater love. There is no greater love. New Hope, people of God, believe the good news. Through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and made whole. Amen. I think we need some amens on that. We have been forgiven and made whole. Woo! Come on now. Come on now. The power of sin is broken, and the doors to new life swing wide open. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Rejoice, for this is the promise of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In Jesus Christ, you are a new creature. Amen. So now, let us be inspired by the love of Christ through our very own youth. We will have dance, prayer, and singing from our youth department.
Before we pray, please share some Easter love with the people around you with a fist bump, nod, or a smile. Okay, let's come back to our seats.
Okay, let's find our seats. Go ahead.
Okay. Easter symbolizes a time of renewal and new beginnings. Let this season spark in us a rebirth of faith, love, justice, and gratitude. Encourage us to renew our commitments to each other and to play our part in the grand scheme of your creation. Let us pray. Dear God, this Easter weekend, we're reaching out with hopes and wishes that feel a bit larger than us, but we know that they're not too big for you. In this puzzle of a world where pieces seem scattered and sometimes starkly divided, we're asking for your wisdom to see how they all fit together in peace. Show us the way to your wisdom and ways to understand each other better and to find unity even in our differences. We're standing in solidarity with those who feel the weight of injustice on their shoulders. May they find in you the strength to keep going in the hope that brighter days are ahead. Illuminate our paths with justice, ensuring that fairness isn't just an ideal, but a reality for everyone, regardless of where they stand. Love and gratitude are what we want to fill our hearts with, especially now. Help us to love without condition, to appreciate all of the blessings we often overlook, and to extend our hands in generosity to those who need it. Kindness feels like a simple word, but its impact is profound. May our actions ripple outwards with your compassion and warmth, making even the smallest difference in this world vast. Thank you for listening, for guiding, and inspiring us always. Amen.
Amen. Let's give our youth a hand again. Yes. It's so good to see our youth, and hopefully we can see them a little bit more. And we just thank our youth department as well for all of the hard work that they've put in. Amen. 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 Okay, so again, I guess we do it twice. So we'll have our passing of the peace. So just take a few minutes to greet your neighbor again. And it's Easter, so we'll change it up just a little bit. So once the music has stopped, we ask that you come back to your seats. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. The Bible says, wherever two or three are gathered in my name, I am in the midst. Thank you all for being here. One of the things I believe very strongly about Scripture is that it speaks to us where we are. It speaks to us currently, not necessarily always focused in a past that is archaic and unrelated to where we are living now and what we are doing now. And so you're going to get the sense of what I'm talking about as I share our Easter passage with you. When I read the text, Mark 16, 1 through 8, what came to mind was expect the unexpected. Certainly there is pith in this expression, but yet a positive point of view. The women in our passage, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, takes spices to anoint the body of Jesus who had been entombed. Their singular worry was, how do we move the stone at the mouth of the tomb? Of course, that concern was allied by the unexpected. They found the stone had already been moved, and they found a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting inside peacefully, and it was alarming. Nevertheless, the elephant in the room, as we look at this story, was written not about matters of fact, and I'll use a word that may sound a little strange, not about matters of fact or facticity. The story was and still is about gender and gender preference, sexism, especially given the issues we're facing as a country. You'll hear me now. Given the social climate of that day, the issues surrounding this story was sexism. Women who were thought to be second-class citizens, untrustworthy, who were not allowed to testify in the courts of law in Jerusalem by way of Golgotha, according to many New Testament scholars. And while the testimony of the male disciples would have been more readily accepted and believed, the fact that the majority of men who were with these women and with Jesus quite likely were running away after the crucifixion. Think about it. Afraid of being captured, hauled into court, and even being crucified, they needed to get out of town. They needed to go to Galilee about a week away. And so what you have are the women who step forward and who move towards attempting to anoint the body of Jesus. And so the role of women in this instance was to be loyal followers of our Lord, as it is here recorded in Mark 16, the oldest of the four Gospels, underscoring their power and courage, and then as well as today, their role in society. In the text of our story, verse 1, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, They saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And so what we have is the Word of God, piercing the division between what is living and active, soul and spirit, joints and marrow, but also our collective thoughts and intentions of the heart. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let's hear it for our praise team. This is by far my favorite weekend of the year, because ever since I became a Christian, you know, I thought Christmas was the day we were supposed to celebrate. And as amazing as that is and was, Jesus was born. If I could go back in time, I saw a baby. Okay. But this was different. I imagine myself being with the disciples, being with him day in and day out, seeing him heal, see him drive out demons, and know that he is the Messiah. And how I must have felt on Good Friday when I saw him beaten. And, you know, we talk about beaten by the soldiers. It wasn't just soldiers. This was Roman centurions. This is the equivalent of the Navy SEALs. Okay, these were the best of the best, and they just obliterated him. Then they flogged him. Usually you die during the flogging. But after that, they crucified him. And then seen him hang on the cross and then die. I've been in the security industry for 30 years. I've seen dead bodies. I know what death looks like. I can imagine myself looking at the Messiah on the cross as a dead man. My world would have been shattered. I would have been broken. That's what I think about. And then on that Sunday, he rose. And he was so much better than ever. And the reason why is because now there was salvation for everybody. It is done. There's nothing else that needs to be done. Give your heart to Jesus. That's the rest is on us. Everything else is the penalty has been paid. I am in love with this church. You know, Pastor had to have surgery. She wants to be here because I know in her heart she feels like, as a lot of leaders do, that if I don't do it, it won't get done and things will fall apart if I'm not there. Well, right? And 9 times out of 10, it's right. If you want something done right, you got to do it yourself. But you know what? Not this church. We have bent strength.
Yes.
We are all, out of many, we are one.
Yes.
This church does amazing things. You know, this church is actually on the land that used to belong to St. Paul. They opened up in 1957. Their members got older. Place became a ghost town. It's quiet. There's nobody here. Services are down to less than 10 people. What's going to happen? The community I live in, they knocked down churches to build houses. I saw two of them that happened too. The leadership there said, please don't let that happen here. The thing I love about our church is we don't view it as our church. This is God's church, and we want to serve him. So what happens here now? We support a Boy Scout troop. We support AA programs. We support a food bank. We support tons of events. Rarely is there a time when our parking lot's not full. You know, I can imagine how the members of St. Paul were feeling. Devastated. Their world's rocked. What happens now? But look at us now.
Yes.
I don't know where you are today. I don't know if you've accepted Christ. I don't know if you're going through some hard times with health or finances or job. But I can tell you my story. 2023 was the worst year I ever had. I'm 52 years old. It's not easy for me to find new work. And in January of last year, I got laid off. The job interviews came, but no offers. And the offers I did get were less than half of what I was making before. During that year, I worked 5 jobs. I was working 7 days a week, 14 hours a day most days. And you know what? God provides, because when I did my taxes, I made the same amount of money as I did the previous year. That's God. God's not a genie. You don't just ask him and it happens. The proper way to ask is, Lord, guide me in where you want me to be. But be careful what you wish for, because I said that about my job that I got laid off from. And I'll be real with you. God, you know what you're doing? Because the road ahead doesn't look very good. So I was on my lunch break at the job. I'm only making a quarter of what I was making before. And that ends at 4. And then I have to work at my other job until 10 and then do it all over again. Got a phone call. Hi, we found you on LinkedIn. We have a job that's going to pay you more than you've ever made before. You pretty much got the job. You available for an interview? Sure, God. Yeah, we'll take that. And the job that I'm in, I'm passionate about, because everything I did, I said 30 years in the security business, it all brought me up to what I'm doing now, and I absolutely love it. So wherever you are today, give it to God. I guarantee you, your worst day with God is better than your best day without him. All you have to do is give your heart to him and say, lead me where you want me to go, and you'll be amazed at how things just fall into place. We got a few more people that are going to talk, and most likely they'll do a better job than me. So keep your ears open, because it's going to be even better. All right, I'm going to go ahead and introduce Lauren. Thank you.
Good evening, New Hope. So I'm here this evening to share with you what the resurrection means to me, but also what it can mean for all of us after Easter. So how do we remember the resurrection like we are reminded of the crucifixion? So Christians, a lot of Christians, we wear crosses, right? We wear them on our necks, earrings, shirts, cars, tattoos, whatever it is, you know? It's a symbol, right? Because and symbols evoke things. They have meaning, feelings, right? Symbols can be people. Symbols can be events. Symbols can show us how far we've come. Symbols can show us, you know, how far we got to go. But the one thing about symbols is that they don't all the time necessarily translate into actions, right? And now to be clear, I'm not coming for your cross. So I'm not saying take your cross off. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is that believing in the resurrection is not enough. It also requires action. So how do we transition from symbols or rituals into action? So, you know, there are some things that community and family just can't do. So we have to take it to God. And a part of resurrection living, I believe, is asking the Lord to resurrect some attributes, right? And that's different for everybody. So let's say maybe over here, some of you need to ask the Lord to resurrect some compassion, right? And maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 people over here need to ask the Lord to resurrect some empathy. But whatever it is for you, well, we have to engage with the Lord post-resurrection. And I know some of you are thinking, well, I talk to the Lord every day. So what do you mean? Why do I need to engage? What are you talking about? Well, let me see if I can help you understand. So let's say that this is post-resurrection. Let's say it's a random Monday in June. And I might say, Lord, I'm about 5 seconds away from sending this passive-aggressive petty email to this person. Because she said that I didn't send her the information, and I got screenshots that I did. So, you know, Lord, I think I might need you to resurrect some kindness within me so I can change the way that I approach people that I'm in conflict with. And maybe it's the 21st night of September, and I'm 1 foot in and I'm 1 foot out because I had this dream in my head about something I wanted to do, but it's not working out like I thought it would. And so maybe I'm thinking I'm not the right person. Maybe I need extra validation from somebody else. Maybe I need to research a little bit more. Lord, I'm feeling doubt. I don't know what to do, but maybe I just need to ask the Lord to resurrect some courage for me. Because maybe I need the Lord to resurrect some courage so that I can let fear know that its presence is no longer needed. Its presence is no longer needed. And maybe it's the December 24th and I need God to do something really big for me. I really need the Lord to show out. And I might say, Lord, I need you to go deep within me. And I need you to take a trip to the cemetery of my soul. And I need you to resurrect the hope that I put there. And I need you to resurrect it back up, so that I can let apathy know that its services are no longer needed. And you don't have to go home, but you gotta get up out of here because hope has its rightful place. You see, we honor Jesus' sacrifice by as many times as necessary reaching out to the Lord with the request to resurrect those qualities that, when they are left to die by us, stunt our growth as Christians. And when we ask God to resurrect these qualities, then we are living a Christ-centered life. Then we can honor the resurrection with our daily actions. And so, what qualities or attributes does God need to resurrect inside of you? I want you to think about it. And I want you Well, I want us to engage and connect with God so much that the tombs and graves of our souls are continuously being emptied. Thank you.
I love church. Mm-hmm. We need some help sometimes. I hate to change the atmosphere a little, but we're going to get back, okay? I don't know about anyone else. I limped through Lent a little bit. Easter is not always easy to get into. Hope does not always seem to be an option that makes sense. And it feels like the more that we see the world for what it is, the more our hearts are actually opened to the experiences of those around us. The more we do get resurrected into empathy, the more we have to feel. There are so many things in the world that it feels like we would have to ignore and deny in order to have this day. Yes. Put on the right clothes, put on the positive mindset. Let's put those things aside. Yes. But that's not what the resurrection is. Yes. The resurrection shows us that positive thinking isn't going to do it. But you don't have to leave those things at the door, because the pathway to hope is through death. We engage in that. We feel it even today. And Hebrews 4:15, Jesus was tempted in every way. It says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin." He knew what it was like to see that despair seemed like the best option. The scene in the garden is put there on purpose, because we need to see Jesus wrestle with despair before we get to the resurrection. And yet we see that he chose hope. Many of you on your best day are doing things that don't feel like they matter in the face of this earth, in the face of your circumstances. You are the women, the faithful disciples, showing up to a rock that doesn't seem like it's going to move. You may feel like on your best day, all you are doing is preparing to anoint the dead body of your dreams of what could be. But if you didn't show up, you wouldn't get to see that the stone is moved. But here's the thing. Not all of us are even able to show up every day. There were a lot of disciples who were not at the tomb. God doesn't care. He finds his people, right, who are in that place able to carry us there. They're going to run back and tell you. If despair is close, if you weren't able to show up to the tomb today, that's okay. God uses, as Reverend Don talked to us about, unlikely sources to see that hope is our best option. There are 100 pairs of arms that he has put in this church to hold each other. Amen. We're not all going to show up to the tomb on the same day, but one of us is. You are going to get to see the resurrection, the love of God in Faye's dance, in Nyla's prayer, in Alex's hope despite circumstances, And Lauren, leading us into what does it look like to be restored?
Yes.
We get to celebrate the fact that God's love is bigger, and it doesn't ignore despair. It looks it straight in the eye and says, yet I choose hope.
Yes.
Jesus is the foundation upon which the kingdom of God is built, and we get to build that love together.
Yeah.
And I am so honored and blessed that today I get to feel the love of God from all of you.
Yeah.
To reflect on where it was born, but it did not stay there.
Mm-hmm.
It is here, it is beautiful, and it is sufficient.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Woo, baby. Following those three people. Let us take a collective breath. Yes. I'm going to pray before I do announcements. If I can get through it. Ooh, gosh. Gracious and loving God, you have joined us together. You have joined us together to hear the incredible stories of hope, love, despair, hanging on, tombs that can't be opened, tombs that we lay our hopes at. But God, right? Your word many times tells us, but God, you are the final answer. You are the final answer. And God, we celebrate you today. We celebrate you today in all of who you are, in all of how this mortal flesh and weak brain can bring it all together. But God, we lay ourselves down at the cross so that you might resurrect us into all that you have called us to be. And the people of God said amen.
Amen.
Whew, baby. It's good to be back. I've missed you. Are there any first-time visitors with us today? Well, hello. Do you feel up to sort of standing up and giving us your name and telling us how you got here? Amen. We welcome you. We have a token of our appreciation that you are here with us today. And if you would fill out that card so that we can keep you in our prayers and be in contact with you. We're so grateful that you're here. Lauren said, the resurrection isn't enough unless we go and put it into action. Oh, we have another. Oh, well, there you go. Would you mind? So Audrey's in the back going. So Audrey's going to make this person introduce herself to us. Oh, two people. Hi. Wow. Yes, yes, thank you. Yes, yes. Well, we are grateful that you are here with us tonight, and for all the blessings you bring to this church, that we might partner with you to give to those who wouldn't otherwise get health. Amen. So, as I was, I was glad I was shown by Audrey my next step. She usually does that. How many of you can say she tells you what your next step is? Audrey. Oh, yeah. You owe me. So, as you exit, you will be given this card. And on this card, it's 1 Peter 2:24. And it says, Jesus himself bore our sin in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness by his wounds. You have been healed. And there's a picture of the open tomb and the three crosses. And as you get this, I invite you to just ponder that as you make the long trek across, and it's not raining. So, as you go over there, ponder this. You have been healed. You have been forgiven. It has been wiped clean. And you put these in the basket as a symbol that you are laying down all those burdens, the things that Ben talked about, and Alex, and Lauren, you lay it at the foot of the cross. Amen. You lay it there. And then you take the promise off the cross with you to keep. And it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, you are a new creation. A new creation has come, the old is gone, and the new is here. I've heard this throughout this evening. The new is here. You are the new that is here. So I invite you to take this with you. Are we going over to the fellowship hall? Okay, as you trek over to the fellowship hall, just in case you would like to keep the bookmark, I will bring those over and you can take one. But I think it's really important for the action to put it down at the foot of the cross. If you picked it back up, that would be exactly what we do in our lives. Ooh, I'm picking it back up. I want to make an announcement that there, oh, it's right there. So I encourage you, if you haven't had enough of that awesome fish fry last night and this beautiful, full worship service, I invite you to come tomorrow. It is going to be beautiful. Not just because I'm preaching, but we have a combined service with a Hunji congregation that has lived through, I believe, every single pastor that has ever been at this church. And so, Reverend Lee is preaching in English. I don't preach in Korean. He preaches in Korean. The English will be up on the screen. I will preach in English, and the Korean will be up in the screen. What I'm having you do tonight, they will do tomorrow in Korean. We have music from New Hope. We won't have, we will not have Pastor Chinetta. Even though it's sort of written in there, I don't think she's coming. No. Okay. Well, I will just make that work. And then afterwards, the Hanji Church is providing a huge Korean banquet for us to be a welcomed guest. This is going to be very powerful because we are literally tying ropes of love and connection between these two congregations together tomorrow. I believe this has never been done like this before in this church. So if you would like to, at 10:30 tomorrow morning, you sleep in, get your chocolate, eggs, and whatever, jelly beans and everything else, and come to church at 10:30. And I want to invite you to give your attention to our announcements that will be on the screen. Thank you.
Busy building the kingdom of God. Before we leave tonight, I'd like to ask Miss Bertha Andrews to please stand. Yes, ma'am. We want to recognize you for the wonderful fish fry and the way in which you conducted it. Thank you so much. And we also want to say thank you for the dinner today, tonight, the wonderful dinner as well. So thank you. Okay. I was spending a moment with the youth, and I was with the teens, and they had the scripture, John 6, I think 36, feed me till I want no more is based on, and they were drawing and painting, and I encourage you when you go over there to take a look at what they did. It's wonderful. The way in which they put their thoughts and energy into what they did. I mean, it's just cool stuff to look at. I think you'll be surprised at how talented. No, you won't, because you know them. They're here. So I take that back. It has been wonderful being with you this Easter weekend. If you may rise, we'll have our benediction. Oh, I'm sorry. We haven't done the offering. I'm sorry. It's okay. Yes, I'll bless the offering. I want to just say, take a moment to think about giving and supporting your church. There are plenty of ways in which you can do it. They're going to put them up on the screen, but we do have four ways in which you can make your contribution to the church so that we can continue doing good God's work. I will pray for the offering and also for the food that we're going to receive. God, I thank you for the gifts that we are going to receive and that you're going to bless and multiply, that we'll be able to do so much in your name. God, I ask that you keep our eyes on you. Let us fix our eyes on you. And we pray this. Oh, I'm sorry, Lord. Can you also bless the food so that we will be able to do more work in your honor? Pray this in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So I ask that we leave with this. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. He lifts his countenance upon you and gives you peace. Go in peace.